Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Chesapeake Annual Celebration. We're very, very excited that you're all here with us. As you enter today, you are muted and you will be muted throughout the program. Please take a moment to send a chat, including your name, congregation, and or where you're from, and a greeting to the honorees. The chat function on the bottom of your screen will be open for the first 15 minutes of the program, and then again after the musical performance, or before the musical performance, towards the end of the program. We will be including the text of the chat in a follow-up email that you'll get later this week with the recording of today as well. We are so excited that you're here. There are over 200 people registered to join today, and we really would like you all to share greetings so that all the honorees can see you. Please sit back and enjoy the program. I would like to introduce John Real to begin the formal program.
Bruchim Habayim, everybody. As Jackie said, I'm John Real, co-chair of the Chesapeake Annual Celebration, and I'm also a board member of Reconstructing Judaism. Together with Carol Stern, I'll be guiding you through this afternoon's program. I have to admit, when I said to Jackie how great it would be that we would be holding an annual celebration after the March Madness, I didn't mean instead of March Madness. So it's an example of you have to be really careful what you wish for. This is a really obviously stressful time and uncertain time for all of us with physical distancing and with COVID-19, and we're not certain what the next month, the next 3 months, the next several months are going to bring. But I'm hoping that this afternoon we'll be able to put that aside for a little bit, that we'll all be able to sit back. I want you to imagine that we're all sitting together in Osei Shalom's sanctuary with the dome and the rings of wisdom above us, with the light streaming through the dome, to the blue corbelling on the dome, that we're all together enjoying each other's company and looking forward to a wonderful buffet of food after. We do in fact have a virtual buffet that we'll be offering at the end of the program, and we've reached a new height as far as environmental care of the environment, because we are offering virtual plates and cups that are virtually biodegradable this year. So we've achieved a new level in Reconstructionism's care for the environment. It's wonderful that you all have taken time out of all of the things that you're doing to be part of the celebration. As Jackie said, we have more than 200 participants who have registered, and because of your incredible generosity, we've raised the equivalent amount of money that we would have raised had we been meeting in person. So that's a wonderful tribute to you as members of Reconstructionist affiliates and as members of the Chesapeake region. So I'd like you to pause just for a second and give yourself a virtual round of applause for being here and for your incredible generosity and commitment to the movement. We have, first of all, I'd like to thank, as always, Jackie Land, who has worked incredibly hard to make this virtual meeting possible. So I'd like us all to give Jackie a virtual round of applause. We also have a number of members of the Reconstructing Judaism staff, including Rachel Forth and Jacob Weinberg, who worked incredibly hard behind the scenes and who are working even now to host and co-host our virtual meeting. And we also have Tressa Grauer, who's the head of the Thriving Communities part of Reconstructing Judaism, whom you'll hear from a little bit later. As we begin our formal program, I'd like us to join together in a She'echianu. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, She'echianu v'kiyumanu v'hagiyanu lazman hazeh. I'd now like to introduce the distinguished and esteemed president of Reconstructing Judaism, Rabbi Deborah Waxman, who will begin the formal part of their program with a teaching. Deborah?
Thanks so much, John. It's so good to be with you and with everyone, and I'm so grateful for the faces that I can see. I'm just so grateful to all of you for your resilience and your creativity in showing up. And I hope that in your commitment to the movement and to the, to each other, I hope that in this really, in these unprecedented times, that you're all finding ways to stay grounded and connected. I hope that you are, all the reports are that folks are feeling very well supported by your communities. It's been so moving to hear what everyone is doing in order to support each other. And I hope you feel well supported by Reconstructing Judaism. I'm excited to come together in this way to celebrate the amazing honorees today. To each and to all of you, we're so grateful for all that you do and also for your willingness to adapt with us to move forward with this celebration in a virtual format. And I'm also very happy to be here with Cantor Charlie Bernhardt in this last convening before he retires in the fall. And I want to echo John's appreciation to the Reconstructing Judaism team and everything that they did to pull this together, and to John and to Carol, who will guide us through today. And over the next several weeks, the teachers over the next several weeks, so that we can extend this sweetness. For my teaching, I want to talk to you about theology. I want to just take on a very meaty topic and talk about where we find God in the face of suffering. Thank God, most of us convened here today are okay in a very fundamental way. I am here in my home outside of Philadelphia with my wife, and we are okay, and I presume that's the case for all of us convening today. But even as at this moment we're okay, we know people who aren't, and we're all living with a keen awareness of intense suffering at all times. And at this moment, we are aware of that there is exists a virus that preys on people, especially who are already vulnerable, and that there exist structural inequities that are aggravating the widespread economic dislocation and that contribute to an increased likelihood of infection for some people. I know, I presume you do as well, folks who struggle with mental illness and experiences of trauma whose struggles are much greater at this moment. And we're all living with a lot of anxiety about what is coming next. So I want to offer up some reflections from a Reconstructionist perspective on divine justice and on what we might do in the face of suffering. How do we explain it to ourselves? How do we explain this kind of suffering to others? And to point to some of the deepest reservoirs from which we can draw at these challenging moments. So one reason why we are in the kind of conundrum that some of us find ourselves in about struggling at this moment of existential drama has to do with some of the challenges about that modernity has given to us, that with the onset of the Enlightenment came this myth of control. With the beginning in the modern era, prior to the modern era, religion was the explanation for all things. And when we tried to understand our own experience, the wider world, the natural world, there was a religious explanation for it all. And with the Enlightenment, religion receded, secularism emerged, and science and rationalism prevailed. And with this new paradigm came the belief that through scientific investigation, through rationalism, we can explain everything. And for many of us, we believe that with that explanation also came control. And, you know, the Reconstructionist movement emerged in this period, emerged in the early 20th century, at trying to kind of split the difference between religion and rationalism. The early Reconstructionists, led by Rabbi Mordecai Kaplan, embraced rationalism for sure, at the same time tried to harmonize rationalism with religion. They set aside the idea that you had to choose one or the other. You could either be a modern rationalist or you could be an old world religious type personality. And one of the things that in my research I encountered very often was were people who were drawn to a Reconstructionist approach because they felt like that they would say that they didn't have to leave my brain at the door. So Kaplan and the circle gathered around him had a huge preoccupation with making the case for how religious people could embrace rationalism. And one of the outcomes of that was that they battled against what they considered irrationalism. And they saw much evidence of that in certain expressions of religion. Most significantly, a deep concern around supernaturalism, around the idea that the laws of nature could be suspended and God would intervene in history. I mean, to put it very, very succinctly, in the holiday that we just completed, celebrating during Passover, the idea that the miracles would be literal, and that furthermore, that we in our day should be looking for that kind of suspension of the laws of nature for rescue, for relief, for redemption. So they spent a lot of time making the case for a religious approach that could embrace rationalism. And for them, it meant setting aside supernaturalism, what they called irrationalism. But what I would put to you is one of the things of this moment is that as much as I resonate so deeply with the analysis and with some of the prescriptions and with some of the solutions that the early Reconstructionists put forward, I resist that binary that they put forward, that it was only about rationalism and irrationalism. Because we know so powerfully, as did they, we know that chaos exists. We know that tremendous suffering exists, some caused by humans, some caused by nature, some, like this pandemic, caused by nature, and it's exacerbated by structural inequities and political responses. Since the Enlightenment, we have lived in a world dominated by rationalism that would like to insist otherwise. But for those of us born in the 20th century and living in the 21st, it seems impossible not to concede the existence of evil in the world. And the hardest part, I think, is acknowledging that evil is not some other figure, not a Satan ultimately answering to God. Evil is a domain that can dwell within us all. In the words of Rabbi Edward Feld, the world contains a primal chaos whose destructive power rises up again and again in history and in the life of each person. It is a realm that cannot be subsumed under the divine. So I want to offer a postmodern correction to the classical Reconstructionist binary of rationalism and irrationalism. And I want to add in a third category that's very important, I think, of non-rationalism, of irrationalism, of that which goes beyond whatever we can investigate and even understand. I'm sure you've all noticed that there's a very strong religious nature to how people are reacting to the current moment. We hear from congregational leaders that folks like you have already always active in your communities, are especially active now, and that rabbis and cantors are very deeply involved in supporting and in helping to make meaning at this time. We've heard in some instances reports of folks who had drifted away rejoining synagogues. I hope you all know about our wonderful website, ritualwell.org, which tends to serve our folks, but also it's representative of a Reconstructionist perspective in the wider world. And it's always had good traffic. We get between 20 and 25,000 unique visitors a month. And it's up to, over 30,000, 35,000 these months. and hopefully you're experiencing, we're working very hard in Philadelphia to show up as a strong resource for you as a religious organization to make sense of this crisis that has a serious existential nature to it. And what the way I understand this turn to the religious is that folks are really experiencing a desire to connect and to locate themselves within a framework that will give offer up wisdom and ethical underpinnings. My experience, my honor as the head of the movement, is that I am at all times making the case for why be Jewish, for what liberal progressive religion can do for people. And one of the things that I say, and that's very, people are very receptive to at this particular moment, is that we do not have to make sense of the world and all of its suffering and all of its beauty on our own. We can draw on the deep wisdom that our ancestors formulated for us and worked through for us to cultivate our own resilience and to chart a path towards surviving and even thriving in the hardest times. So but one of the questions always is about how to have, what is the role of God within this and what is our relationship to the divine? And there is always the Reconstructionist challenge if for many of us, we are desiring a personal relationship. It is a personal relationship, not necessarily with a personal God. And the way my mother always says, that she still to this day feels like God is an old man with a long white beard sitting on a throne judging us. But for those of us who would have a relationship with a different kind of God, sometimes the language is an impersonal God, that we can nonetheless have a deeply personal relationship. So Kaplan and the circle gathered around him who embraced religious humanism suggested that the path toward this was through process theology. That's an understanding of God as the ground of being of the universe, God as the source of goodness and creativity and interconnection. Kaplan would frequently say God is the power that makes for salvation, but that formulation would work in many other settings. So it was often just always about the power, the animating power. At Passover, it was about the power that makes for freedom. And these are, and this is an approach to the divine that is deeply resonant for me, for sure. And those metaphors of wellspring and source of life sustain me in very powerful ways. And I'm also really deeply moved by what's called predicate theology. This is an approach that's strongly implied by Kaplan in his earliest works, but was most powerfully articulated, I think, by one of his disciples, Harold Schulweis. And Schulweis was deeply challenged, especially by the topic of suffering and divine justice. Harold Schulweis pointed, who was a rabbi out in California, pointed out that if we focus on God as the subject, with a capital S, on God as a who, this leads to questions around divine justice, which are hard to answer. And these questions frequently lead to rejection. Because of all the suffering in the world, there are many folks who cannot accept what most Western religious traditions teach. The idea that God is just, with a capital J, God is merciful, God is the healer. Schulweis proposed that we shift our focus from the subject of God to those very predicates. Instead of proposing that God as subject is merciful, there's the predicate. Schulweis taught that when we see mercy, when we see justice or healing, all those predicates that are traditionally attributed to the divine, when we see those qualities, then we can know that godliness, that the quality of the divine is present. And Schulweis, in addition to being deeply influenced by Mordecai Kaplan, was also influenced by Martin Buber. So he put relationship at the center of this understanding of godliness. Schulweis encouraged us to ask not where is God, but rather when is God? And he suggested that the answer was almost always in our interactions with each other, most especially when those interactions contribute to the collective good. I think the most concise way to understand what he was talking about is to quote Rabbi Fred Rogers. You might see this pop up on Facebook whenever there's a challenging time that Mr. Rogers used to say, look for the helpers, look for the helpers. And I think what he was saying there is, look for the helpers, there you will see godliness. And I think what he was saying, what is at the heart of predicate theology, is we too can enact those qualities and in that way cultivate godliness, cultivate goodness. The truth of reality is that good and evil are not separate realms, but are intertwined. Writing about faith after the Holocaust, Rabbi Richard Rubinstein observes that we all have the potential to let evil gain dominion in our hearts and in our social order. And equally true is that we all have the potential to be seekers of the sacred and to be bearers of a larger vision, one of humanity and holiness and hopefulness. Such a quest, we know, is a struggle, because we have to actively work to make room for the holy, for this connection to the divine. And we have learned in the hardest possible ways that holiness does not happen on its own. We have to cultivate it. Embracing this kind of non-personal theology, I think, liberates us from vexing questions. This approach frees us from classical theological assertions that God must be omnipresent, omniscient, omnipotent. God must be all-present, all-knowing, all-powerful. By giving up on these qualities, by making space for laws of nature that are binding and for the randomness of the universe, we can make a renewed case for God and for religion. We can set aside the heavy task of justifying God and can instead tap into wellsprings of mercy and creativity that emerge from and point back to God. Understanding God as the source of the universe is not simply a philosophical claim. It's a truth that is affirmed with the birth of every child. It's renewed with each encounter with beauty, be it natural or created. It's awakened every time we benefit from the inspirations of inventors and the extraordinary acts of heroism by caregivers that we're seeing every day. In the face of suffering, we can find comfort and begin to make meaning. In his best-selling book, When Bad Things Happen to Good People, Rabbi Harold Kushner writes, science can describe what has happened to a person, but only religion can call it a tragedy. Only the voice of religion, when it frees itself from the need to defend and justify God for all that happens, can say to the afflicted person, you are a good person and you deserve better. Come, let me come and sit with you so that you will know that you are not alone. And that's one of our biggest challenges right now, for us to figure out how it is that we sit together and also observe the social distancing. And this virtual way of connecting is such a critical way for us to come together, to sit together, to affirm that which we think is most important. We've just completed Passover, the celebration of the liberation of our ancestors. We're now in the Omer period, newly liberated, moving through the desert, heading towards Sinai. We know that our ancestors were not freed to do anything they wanted to do. They were freed to enter into covenant with the divine and with each other to create a just and caring society bound up in the liberation of others along with themselves. We Reconstructionists ask, how can we set aside supernaturalism and retain the power and inspiration of God the Redeemer? Throughout the year, we constantly ask, how do we stay in conversation with our ancestors in ways that can be meaningful and full of integrity for us and compelling to our children? We ask again and again because we presume that the answers will change, that they are always changing. We understand that we are empowered to make certain these changing answers are substantive and relevant. We insist that it is possible to reach for redemption in the modern era. We can draw strength from the power of our story and use that strength to work as co-creators with the divine to bring about a redeemed world. This isn't easy. It takes work to embrace the rigorous questioning that a rational approach requires and to presume that we can end with a stance of belief. But we choose to believe in some version of the divine, in some vision of the Jewish people, because belief affirms a beneficent universe even when we witness terrible sufferings. Belief fuels optimism even as we struggle in the trenches. We believe our ancestors marched from Egypt to encounter the divine at Sinai and recorded what they experienced in the Torah. That recording was tempered by their human limitations, heavily shaped by their social context. And we also believe that revelation is continuous. We are marching towards Sinai right now on the 10th day of the Omer. It is our work as Reconstructionist Jews to discern revelation and enact the covenant between God and the Jewish people in ways that are meaningful for today's world. We do this always remembering our own personal and social limitations, always seeking to recapture that redeeming moment at the sea. So here's my take on redemption in the modern era, what we're supposed to do while we're on this planet at all times, and especially now at a moment of extremity. We acknowledge our creatureliness, that we are limited and imperfect. And at the same time, we acknowledge the immense intelligence and agency that we human beings possess. I take to heart the teaching of Rabbi Simcha Bunim of Peschischa. He taught that we should carry in our notes two pockets, in our pockets two notes. One should have the word, I am but dust and ashes, and the other should say, for my sake, the world was created. We are co-creators with the divine. We once were slaves and now are free. We willingly assume the obligation to work for the liberation of others. I'll close with the words of Seamus Heaney, the Irish Nobel laureate, the poet of another people's oppression. He wrote, history says, don't hope on this side of the grave. But then, once in a lifetime, the longed-for tidal wave of justice can rise up and hope and history rhyme. We progressive religious people walk a fine and even poetic line between rationalism and belief. We believe that God is in the rhyming. These are intense times, full of suffering and also full of opportunities for us to rise up and act out godliness. How we do this will look different for each of us, but for all of us, as Seamus Heaney says, we can and must make hope and history rhyme. Be safe, take good care of yourselves, stay connected with each other and with us, and I look forward to the next time when we're all together in person.
Thank you, Deborah. That was a wonderfully powerful message, and Reconstructionism truly teaching at its best. Thank you for being with us, Deborah, and for offering that teaching. I'd like now to invite Tressa Grauer to speak. Tressa is the head of the Thriving Communities Department of Reconstructing Judaism. and she'll give us some updates about what's going on with the movement and what we can expect perhaps in the future from Reconstructing Judaism. Tressa?
Thanks, John. Hello, all. I'm Tressa Grauer. I'm Vice President for Thriving Communities at Reconstructing Judaism, and it really is a great pleasure to be with you all again, celebrating the exceptional members of the Chesapeake community, and some of whom are being recognized this afternoon and who I can see on my screen. You all can as well. I'm really delighted to be able to recognize your support for your congregations and your Chavah Rot and of the Reconstructionist movement writ large. It's all of you who give your time and your talents and your experience and who make this movement thrive. You are the thriving in our thriving communities. So, toda rabba lechem. Thank you for your commitment. Before I say a few words about what's happening in the movement, I want to say that this day could not have happened without the hard work of many, many people. I want to express my gratitude to the hosts, to John Reel and to Carol Stern, not only for emceeing this event, but also for really helping us to think through how we could transition this program from an in-person event to a virtual one. Thank you in advance to Cantor Charlie Bernhardt for your musical offerings this afternoon. Thank you, Deborah Waxman, for your teaching. To the staff in Philadelphia, especially Rachel Forth, Rosa Cohen, Rachel Burgess, Jacob Weinberg, Bob Rashad, thank you for all of the behind the scenes work, including the program and the registration, the beautiful tribute journal, and all of the technology. And finally, a very, very special thank you to Jackie Land, who oversaw all of the logistics for this program from start to finish, and who handled the uncertainties of this new format with all of her usual grace. So thank you to all of you. I want to take a few minutes now to tell you just a little bit about what we've been doing at Reconstructing Judaism since the beginning of the year. I wish that I could report to you about the wonderful Southern California Shabbaton that we had been planning for late March, involving four of our congregations in California, but unfortunately that had to be canceled because of the pandemic. I know that you all know what it's like to have to brokenheartedly cancel the things that you've been planning and looking forward to for so long. But I can tell you about a wonderful program that we held in New York in January, in which we partnered with Project Renewal to present a Jewish response to homelessness. For that program, we brought together about 140 people with experts and practitioners on the ground. And much of that material has been captured on video. So I hope that you take advantage of this resource and are able to use this in your communities, especially now when we are all looking for opportunities to learn together from our own homes. For those of you who've participated in the annual Day of Learning and Celebration for the last few years for Chesapeake, you'll remember that we have had a keynote speaker and several breakout sessions in the past as parts of the program. This year, rather than keeping you on Zoom for the whole afternoon, we've decided to space out those learning opportunities over the next few weeks, and we are holding a special Reconstructionist Learning Series that's being sponsored by the Chesapeake region. So you'll hear more about this as we go, but this program is going to kick off next Saturday, April 26th, with Rabbi Jacob Staub, who will be leading a workshop entitled Reconstructionism, Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow. I have to, of course, mention that planning is well underway for our next convention in March of 2022. We're calling this program Biyachad, Reconstructing Judaism Together. And I'm sure that you will be happy to know, if you don't know already, that this convention is going to be held in your backyard at the Hilton McLean in Tyson's Corner, Virginia, and that your very own John Reel is one of the co-chairs of this event. So if it's not already on your calendar, please make sure that you save the dates. That's March 23rd through 27th of 2022. Mostly, of course, what we've been doing most recently at Reconstructing Judaism is reimagining how we help Reconstructionists connect during this time of physical distancing. This work has taken many forms, starting with what I would say the very practical effort of making our liturgy available digitally, including the Kol HaNeshama Sidurim and the prayers for the House of Mourning, as well as the Reconstructionist Haggadah, a night of questions, which alone was downloaded more than 3,200 times before Passover. So it has really been much appreciated and well used.
Tressa, you're moving your microphone a lot. If you could
okay.
Keep your microphone still.
Is that better?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, sorry, John. More things that we're offering digitally, I just want to mention a few. The Innovation and Impact Department spearheaded the creation of the virtual Shabbat box on March 13th, and this has been a weekly offering for the last 5 weeks. We also created a virtual Passover box in collaboration with the RRA and the Rabbinical College and Havaya at Home, which is how Camp Havaya has moved into this new moment. And we have also created a new forum called Recon Connect, in which we are taking live resources from our congregations and from the college and making them available to you so that you can all tap into and access some of the best of the live learning that's happening across the movement. The last thing I want to mention is that since March 12th, even before we closed our building, the Thriving Communities Department has been holding regular calls for presidents, for educators, for executive directors, and looking for opportunities that enable folks to come together to discuss their responses to the pandemic. As I know I don't need to tell you, there are lots of unprecedented questions that need answers at this point. And we've been working with our communities through the waves of understanding of just how widespread the effects of COVID-19 are going to be. So those conversations have allowed us to talk about all kinds of things, everything from how we move our services and our schools online, to how to conduct B'nai Mitzvah and funerals virtually, to how our congregations can apply for federal aid, to how we make the most of Zoom. I've been amazed and inspired by the generosity of these conversations and repeatedly aware that all the folks in our communities really see the value of learning from each other as part of the larger movement. And just to build on what Deborah was talking about earlier, this is when is God, right? In our interactions with each other, working toward the common good. So these are just some of the forums and the formats in which we share the actions and the programs and the knowledge and the perspectives that all of you create. And I am very, very proud of all of the work that we do together. I applaud the honorees here today, your strength, your vitality, the communities that you have created. I wish you all health and strength and joy in this moment and the blessing of community, both actual and virtual. May you go from strength to strength.
Thank you, Tressa. I'm Carol Stern, and I'm from Adat Shalom. This afternoon, we will be honoring members of our community with a Hineni Award for those who have consistently and eagerly stepped up and said, Hineni, here I am, took on extra roles and responsibilities as needed in their community. We will be inviting one or two members of each community to do a short intro of the honoree from their congregation. As is our tradition, the honorees won't be speaking during the program. Their words are printed in the tribute journal, which you have all received in an electronic version today. Please take some time to read it and learn more about our honorees and the movement. After each honoree is introduced, we will ask each honoree to just say thank you so that you can see and recognize them for all that they have done. Each honoree has received a copy of A Night of Questions, the Reconstructionist Haggadah, and will be receiving a professionally printed version of the tribute journal with all the information and beautiful tributes and a certificate recognizing them with the Hineni Award. I would now like to invite Shelley Sadowski and Hal Siegel from Adat Shalom to introduce the first honorees, Pam Summers and Fred Pinkney.
Even in a community of environmentalists, Fred Pinkney stands out for walking the talk and doing so with notable humility. For the last 10 years, he spearheaded, and 10 years ago created and has spearheaded the maintenance of what we call our Mishnah garden, which has provided hundreds of pounds of vegetables, fruit and vegetables, to homeless shelters in the DC area. This is really an effort to apply Jewish agricultural values to the building of community. He's done the same with a community in Haiti, which to which we have regular missions. And when he's not gardening and volunteering at Adat Shalom, Fred is a highly respected scientist with the United States Fish and Wildlife Service, focused on scientific studies of the effects of contaminants on fish and efforts to clean up those rivers, particularly the Anacostia, which is now probably the biggest environmental cleanup effort ever in the DC area. And I can tell you from my own personal experience in that context that Fred is regarded by the local and federal government entities, by the NGOs and the private sector as literally, I would say, the Dr. Fauci of the Anacostia River. He's also married to Pam Summers, who is also receiving recognition today. And together, they are real rocks of our community.
And I'm going to take over from there to let you know a little bit about Pam for those of you who don't know her. Pam is a fixture at Adat Shalom, but when I say fixture, I don't mean something like a statue. Pam is always on the move with her minions, either gathering them together, pushing them forward, making sure they're behind her. And when I speak of her minions, I'm speaking about the youth in our community. Pam has single-handedly taken on the role of substitute mom, teacher, director. I can't think of other descriptions, but Pam has a group called Chords of Glory, Performance with a Purpose. These are tweens and teens who sing together, both helping out at shelters and providing their voices at senior centers, but also gracing our Bima many times a year. And we love them, and we are so thankful for Bam for bringing them to us. She has also taken on, spearheaded a project called Tikkun Ha'ir, Repairing the City, where she takes teens into the city of DC for a few days of learning and service. And it's quite an immersive experience. And they have come back and told us about their stories at Shabbat services. And I'm sure they are transformative experiences for all the kids. And for that, Pam, we thank you for bringing the Jewish values of Tikkun Olam to Tikkun Ha'ir, bringing it into the city. Pam has also worked with our girls in Rosh Chodesh groups, leading monthly groups of discussion for young girls, tweens, and teens who may need to be able to speak to their peers and also to a wonderful leader like Pam. And she's also within Adat Shalom, she has spearheaded something called Teen Torah Takeover, where twice a year our teens come to the Bima and lead the Torah discussion. And she's also brought the teens into the High Holiday services, which has been quite an enhancement. So, and lastly, besides the teens, we know that Pam has been on the Bima many, many times with her beautiful singing voice. She is a member of our choir. She is a member of a trio of singers with her wonderful sister and our wonderful Rabbi Rachel. And she has also, in addition to gracing us with her voice, she has led and directed the Haiti mission for 5 years. So for all of these reasons, we have honored Pam today, and I'm going to close with a very short little song portion just for you, Pam. And it's summer's time and the honoring is easy. Thank you, Pam.
Oh.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Hal. Thank you so much.
Mazel tov. Pam and Fred, and thank you very much, Shelley and Hal. I'd like now to invite Eli Ines from Beit Tikva to to introduce Ken Staubs. So, Eli?
Thank you, John. There are many reasons Beit Tikva is honoring Ken Staubs today. Ken is a volunteer extraordinaire. He is the one who shows up early for every Beit Tikva service and event, prepared to do whatever is needed to make those services happen. Because we share our building with other groups, Ken actually moves and sets up all of our religious items, equipment, furniture, in whatever space we're using that day. He has schlepped things for us in his pickup truck. He's constructed and then dismantled our sukkah every year. And he's used his woodworking talents to design and carve a beautiful piece of art for us to display. These are just some of the ways in which Ken has stepped up to serve our congregation. Ken has a very interesting background. He was born and raised as a Methodist in rural Anne Arundel County in Maryland. As a youngster attending Sunday school, Ken knew even then that he didn't belong there. He would often escape class and then return to the church parking lot just in time for his mother to pick him up. However, his mother didn't tell him the family secret until 50 years later. Ken's first introduction to Judaism came when he met his future wife, Karen, who told him that she couldn't marry a non-Jew. So Ken converted to Judaism and Beit Tikva became his spiritual home. He and Karen and their family became active participants in synagogue life. In 2016, Ken took a DNA test. Surprisingly, it showed that he had Eastern European Jewish roots. When he questioned his mother, she admitted that her great-grandmother was actually Jewish. So, according to matrilineal descent, Ken was Jewish after all. We congratulate Ken on being honored today, and we thank him for his steadfast dedication and commitment to Beit Tikva. Thank you, Ken.
Thank you, and congratulations, Ken. I would like to now invite Alan Pomeranz from CJC to introduce Betty and Peter Silverglate.
Good afternoon, everybody. I was told that we had 2 minutes, and if you know me and my congregation, yeah, that just ain't gonna happen. But I have cut it down to the 2 minutes. Peter and Betty joined Reconstructing Judaism in about 1987 from a congregation in Connecticut, Shira Shalom. I'm here to introduce these Columbia Jewish Congregation honorees for the 2020 Regional Reconstructing Judaism Honors. Peter and Betty Silverglate have been active members of our community for many years. And when I say active, it is truly an understatement. Betty is a longtime Adult Education Committee member currently serving as its co-chair. She is an adult bat mitzvah of CJC and has served on our board of directors. When you meet her, she comes across as quiet and introverted. She is far from it. Just ask Peter and her kids. Our adult ed classes have thrived under her leadership, and she was a very instrumental part of our board, adding thoughtful and insightful ideas. Peter definitely keeps up with his wife. He attends all adult ed and Bible study programming. He has lectured our community on self-publishing as a very active member of our men's, now called Mensch Club. He is one of our lay leaders of Shabbat services, is extremely active in the Federation and the Reconstructing movement, and come May of this year, will be part of our board of directors. If that wasn't enough, Peter and Betty are at almost every CJC-sponsored activity, service, or congregational meeting. But what I find most incredible, what I find is this most impressive, they have instilled this sense of community, this sense of family, to their adult kids, Lauren and Bobby. We see them at CJC events almost as much as their parents. The Silverglates are the role model family I wish all CJCs would take lessons from. They embody the spirit of Mishpacha. It is my true honor and privilege to introduce CJC's honorees, Betty and Peter Silverglate.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alan.
Thank you very much, Alan.
Thank you. I'm so happy that everybody is using Reconstructing Judaism, the new name of our organization that isn't so new anymore.
John.
Whoops, I apologize. That the only unsmooth part is I flip pages in my Braille script too soon. I'd now like to invite Deborah Linick from Colami to introduce Raina Aylward and Tony Popkin.
Thank you, John. You'll forgive me if I'm reading from a script today. I'm kind of an ad-libber, especially when I know and am so enthusiastic about these two amazing women as I feel about Raina Aylward and Tony Popkin. But if I didn't write my thoughts down, there was no way I was covering all that these women do in the 2 minutes I have. So here goes. Raina and Tony had different paths to Reconstructionist Judaism. One started as the daughter of a priest and a Jewish atheist, and no, that's not the start of a joke. The other was a granddaughter to founding members of a conservative shul. Both are founding members of Kol Ami. One served in the diplomatic corps. Both were professionals in the special needs community. One became an award-winning advocate for that community through the hard-earned knowledge she had as someone who daily overcomes an invisible disability. Their service to others shines through their professional years and continues to be a bright, bright light in our congregation and well beyond it. I've dubbed Raina my consigliere. She sometimes calls me DD for Dear Debbie. She was synagogue president before me, and she guides me through this journey in ways that inspire me and raise me up every day. She finds hours to quietly visit with those who are lonely or ill, or to arrange for those visits through the committee. She supports our youth education. She and her husband began our Coyotes, the Colamite of the Year Awards, to recognize others in the community. She does all of this without fanfare while devoting herself to several other nonprofit boards and leadership roles in so many ways throughout the community. And Raina has found a kindred spirit in Tony Popkin as they team up to lead our Care and Concern Committee in this very, very challenging time of COVID. Tony is also the founder of our inclusion committee. She makes sure that we have fidget balls for those with attention deficits, large print or auditory aids wherever possible, and all sorts of accommodations so that we can live up to our radically inclusive goals. Tony has an artistic side. She's the creator of our B'nai Mitzvah gifts, our crafty caring rocks, our thank you cards to frontline COVID responders, the quilt that adorns our Torah table, and the separate one at the Tree of Life Synagogue. I simply cannot gush enough about the ways these two amazing women bring life and grace and comfort and passion and dedication to our community. But I thank you for giving me these 2 minutes to try. Tony and Raina, thank you for all the amazing, amazing things you do and for who you are. Thank you, Reconstructing Judaism, for giving each of us this opportunity to let the brightest lights in our communities shine and be an inspiration to us all.
Thank you, Debbie. It's an honor to be a part of Kol Ami.
Thank you, and Mazel Tov to Raina and Tony. I would now like to invite Janet Mirsky from Mishkan Torah to introduce Mark Lowenstein.
I don't get a chance to say anything.
Raina, sorry.
Where's Raina? Say thank you.
There you go.
Oh, thank you. Do I have a... I love Zoom. Thank you. Thank you, Debbie, for the wonderful tribute. Thank you to my co-honoree, Tony. I just want to thank the members of our Care and Concern Committee, which really is our whole community, which is so caring. So thank you all. Much love.
Janet.
Okay, now? Okay. All right. Mishkan Torah is a small synagogue that relies heavily on volunteers to keep us running. And this is why we're grateful to have Mark Lowenstein as a member and active volunteer. Mark started as an involved parent with our CART family school when his two children were students. He then began developing his Bema skills through practice and is our calling Gabbai on many Shabbat mornings. his children, now in college, still show up to chant from the Torah when they're available. Mark went on to do important jobs behind the scenes. As a chair of the religious committee, he helped organize the yearly high holiday services, which is a huge task. Mark worked with the rabbi, gave out honors, and managed to keep everyone happy and the program moving along smoothly. Mark organizes the rotation of Shabbat morning Kiddush helpers, and that also runs smoothly. Perhaps most importantly, Mark is our webmaster. He manages our website and maintains our emails, both for our membership and for the board, which changes every year. His IT skills have helped extricate many a board member from web and email issues. Mark, Mishkan Torah is very happy you're with us, and we're proud to give you this well-deserved honor today. You exemplify the best traditions in volunteerism at Mishkan Torah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Janet. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you, Janet, and mazel tov, Mark. I would like now to invite Michael Cornell from Osei Shalom to introduce Ann Wittick Brovman and Dan Brovman and Gary and Melanie Magnus as Osei Shalom's honorees. Michael, are you here?
John, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you, and thanks to Reconstructing Judaism for figuring out a way to move into the virtual world like the rest of us have. I have the distinct honor of introducing the honorees from Osei Shalom, Ann Wittick Brovman and Dan Brovman, and Gary and Melody Magnus. Ann Wittick Brovman is currently serving as our membership chair on our board and executive committee. She's the voice of announcements at our Shabbat services and is extremely conscientious in making sure all of our new guests to services or programs feel welcomed and engaged and connecting them with other members. She really helps to build a sense of community that we work so hard to instill within our congregation. She takes care to ensure that all of our volunteers receive the recognition they deeply deserve. Most recently, during the COVID pandemic, she's been spearheading efforts to ensure all of our community members are being reached out to regularly. Her attention to detail and love for Osei matches that of her husband, Dan Brovman. Dan has one of those operatic voices you can't help but recognize during services, whether he's chanting Torah on the Bima or leading services or singing in the choir on high holidays. He's currently serving as our Vice President of Finance and has been shepherding us through the maze of applications and documentation for the various COVID loans that I'm sure we're all applying for. During the rest of the year, he makes sure we stay in great financial condition and that we stay on budget. I can tell you if anyone overspends their budget, Dan will know about it and he'll let you know before the check clears. Gary and Melody Magnus. Melody is a linchpin in our IT and website endeavors. While she works in virtual space, she's frequently filling our physical space either with food preparation or programs for a local soup kitchen, and she's heavily involved in other social justice activities and events. It's rare to see Melody at Osei without Gary and their son, Josh. If there's a need somewhere, chances are Melody and Gary will be involved in seeing it filled. In addition to serving as our webmistress, she's actively involved in our Rosh Chodesh women's group. Gary, and I can't say enough about Gary, when he's not home and he's not at work, he's at Osei. He spends most of his efforts in the physical space, whether it's organizing Habitat for Osei each year to keep our building fresh, bringing in grants for landscaping and rain garden installations, and working with our security committee to ensure we're all in a safe place when we come to worship, study, or play together. During COVID, Gary has been responsible for the safety of those coming into the building, monitoring use during the shutdown, and serving on various ad hoc teams managing the synagogue during the crisis. Gary's frequently engaged in social justice activities alongside Melody and Josh, and currently serves as our administrative VP on our executive committee and our board of directors. All of OSA's honorees are wonderful examples of the spirit of community and caring that is the hallmark of OSA Shalom. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's an honor.
We are very tough and Yasher Koach to all of our honorees. Thank you so much for your service to our congregations in our region. You help make Chesapeake the really truly special place that it is. Before we move on to the concluding part of our program, I would like to take a moment to recognize Sam Seaman, our friend and colleague who recently passed away at age 103. Sam was a wonderful partner, a hard worker, a true Reconstructionist who participated in Chesapeake and national programming for decades. And many of you will remember that he was with us the last year. He will be truly missed.
Thank you, Carol. And I echo Carol's sentiments. I know we especially honored Sam last year, and thank God we did that last year. I'm going to miss Sam terribly. And he, in many ways, was the conscience of the Reconstructionist movement and held steadfast to incredible principles and loyalty toward the movement and to Mordecai Kaplan. So, Sam, wherever you are, I'm sure you're looking down on us and you're saying, thank you for the honors and things you've said, but let's move this program along so we can get to the buffet. Before we conclude our former program, I'd like to invite Cantor Charlie Bernhardt, the Cantor of Osei Shalom, to take the virtual beam up. Charlie has been our Cantor for more than 36 years now. And unfortunately, he'll be retiring at the end of October of this year. So this will be the last opportunity we'll have to see him on the Bema, the virtual Bema or the real Bema in a Reconstructionist gathering as our actual Osei Shalom Cantor. As I noted, and as Rabbi Deborah noted, we are in a very stressful time. Some of us may have lost relatives and loved ones to COVID-19. Others may have lost loved ones. Loved ones may be sick now. I think we're all in need of a little bit of healing at the moment. So I'd like to invite, before he begins his formal singing presentation, I'd like to invite Cantor Charlie to lead us virtually in a prayer for healing. Charlie?
Thank you, John.
Mi she berach avotenu mekor habracha imotenu. May the source of strength who blessed the ones before us help us find the courage, make our lives a blessing. And let us say, Amen. Yishperach imotenu mekor habracha lavotenu. Bless those in need of healing with refuah shlema, renewal of body, renewal of spirit, and let us say, Amen.
Thank you, Charlie. As a reminder, the gates of chat are still open. I know chats have been coming through to all of our honorees throughout the presentation. Please keep those chats coming in. And we'll be keeping that open until the end of the program. Charlie?
Thank you, Yochanan. I've been doing these Reconstructionist honor programs now for quite a number of years. And I'm glad I get to do it one more time before I retire. But it's a special treat that this time I didn't have to set up the sound equipment for this event. Fred Small wrote this song in the mid-1980s. It's a liberating song, sung by a parent to a child. Its message is something for all of our children and for all of us. This is Everything Possible. We have cleared off the table, the leftovers saved, washed the dishes, put them away. I have told you a story and tucked you in tight at the end of your knockabout day. When the moon sets its sail to carry you to sleep over the midnight sea, I will sing you a song no one sang to me. May it keep you good company. You can be anybody that you want to be. You can love whomever you will. You can travel any country that your heart leads, and know I will love you still. You can live by yourself. You can gather friends around. You can choose one special one. And the only measure of your words and your deeds will be the love you leave behind when you're gone. There are girls who grow up strong and bold. Some boys are quiet and shy. Some race on ahead, some follow behind. Some grow in their own way and time. Some women love women, and some men love men. Some raise children, some never do. You can dream all the day, never reaching the end of everything possible for you. Don't be rattled by names, by taunts or games, but seek out spirits true. If you give your friends the best part of yourself, they will give the same back to you. You can be anybody that you want to be. You can love whomever you will. You can travel any country that your heart leads, and know I will love you still. You can live by yourself. You can gather friends around. You can choose one special one. And the only measure of your words and your deeds will be the love you leave behind when you're gone. Oh, the love you leave behind when you're gone. Rabbi Nachman said, "Kol ha'olam kulo gesher tzar me'od." All the world is a very narrow bridge. The ha'ikar lo lefached klal. The important thing is not to let fear overcome us. The COVID-19 virus has us all keenly aware of the narrowness of the bridge we cross. 200 years after Rabbi Nachman, Nelson Mandela said, "I learned that courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. The brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers the fear." I wish all of us koach ugvurah, strength and courage. May we gather together next time in the same room. only a journey across a very narrow bridge. It's a journey you don't know where you're going. Can't hide from it. Don't dare fear from it. And if you're lucky, you'll hear a still small voice. And if you're smart, you'll listen, listen to a voice. It's a journey across a very narrow bridge. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher, gesher tzar me'od. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher, gesher tzar me'od. From every direction, there will be roads to choose. And if you're lucky, you'll like the one who you. It's a journey across a very narrow bridge. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher, gesher tzar me'od. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher, gesher tzar me'od. There will be moments when wrong seem to be right. You must cross the darkness before you reach the light. It's a journey across a very narrow bridge. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher, gesher tzar me'od. 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 To all my fellow Judaism reconstructors, thank you.
Thank you, Charlie. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher tzar me'od. Thank you for helping us all difficult bridges that we're now traversing. Charlie, I'm hoping that in the years to come we'll be able to convince you somehow to keep performing and participating in our Reconstructionist, our Chesapeake annual events. This is wonderful. Thank you for your music, and thank you for your music for us and for Osei Shalom during these past 36 years. Ladies and gentlemen, this pretty much concludes our formal program for this evening. It's been wonderful. The chats are still coming in for all of our honorees and for the participants. Please keep them coming in. I'm hoping to see you all either virtually or in person at our upcoming Reconstructionist events, beginning with the presentation by Dr. Jacob Staub next Sunday, the 26th at 4 o'clock p.m. Jacob Staub will be speaking on Reconstructionism yesterday, today, and tomorrow. For registration, you can check out the Tribute Journal, and I'm sure we'll be sending out something as a link to register in the next few days. I'd like to thank everyone, participants, all of you, honorees, members of the Reconstructionist staff and office, Rabbi Deborah, everyone who made this program such an incredible success this afternoon. Again, thank you so much for all of your generous contributions in helping us reach and even, I would say, surpass our goals for fundraising for this event this year. So as we conclude our program, I would like to raise my glass of Sancerre and ask us all to raise either a virtual glass or a real glass and offer a toast to our honorees, to us as members of the Chesapeake Region of Reconstructionism, and offer a toast to the world that we can bring through our own efforts, healing into the world, and maybe a little more peace and calm into the world over the next few months. And I personally am looking forward to hosting a 24/7 rolling party at the Chesapeake Suite in McLean, Virginia in 2022. So may we go from strength to strength to strength. Chazak, chazak, v'nichazek. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, barei pri hagafen.
L'chaim.
L'chaim.
I am.
I am.
Chazak, chazak, v'nit chazek.
Thank you all.
Thank you. This was a lovely, lovely program. Really terrific.
So lovely, everybody. Thanks so much for being with us all. It was so good to be with everybody.
Absolutely.
Carol, I forgot to thank you.
Oh, thank you, John.
Thank you, everybody. My apologies, Jackie, to anyone who's still listening. Carol deserves a hell of a lot of credit too for co-emceeing this and for being my co-chair of this event.